What's up? What's up? What's up? It is Jameson Tank here, back from the dead. Took a little 2 weeks off from the podcast because I was just a little bit tired of editing videos. Just needed a little break. You know, you got to take a breather sometimes. So yeah, I'm back to it. This is number 24. We have a wonderful, like, March is just slam-packed with awesome guests coming in. So be ready for that. This is the last solo one for a little while. And I actually haven't done one of these in a while. The last one I did was Behind the Music, Too Hot to Hold. And tonight's episode will be Behind the Music Live in 2020 EP, which came out last week, which did really well. Thank you all the people that listened to it. I'm about to give you the scoop on it, about to tell you why we did it, what about it I like, you know, the favorite moments on it, all that kind of good shit. So yeah, this is episode 24. All right. So the Live in 2020 EP. Last year I was lucky enough to have multiple shows of mine recorded. Actually, I kind of tried to make it a point to record as many as I could, just because I'm a huge fan of that in general. Like, I just love listening to, like, think of your favorite band right now. I like listening to their favorite or their earliest tape you can find. You know what I'm saying? Like, the beginning, you know what I mean? So I love stuff like that. Like, I listen to, like, say my favorite band's Van Halen. I listen to, like, tapes from their first year playing tours and stuff all the time. And usually it's on YouTube, which I think is kind of whack that bands, like, hold on to all this material. And I've talked about this on a podcast a couple times, that I don't understand why bands just keep it on the shelves. Like, even if it's not amazing, nobody gives a fuck, just put it out there, you know what I'm saying? And like, wouldn't you kill for another record from your favorite band right now, a live record? Even though, like, some live records are bad, like if it's a forced live record where, like, you can tell the crowd noise is, like, souped up really high and, like, it's just artificial sounding, you know what I mean? But like, a really, like, just a solid band playing live record is what I really like. And that's why I wanted to do it. So last year, I was lucky enough to have 40 Watt recorded, played there twice, and had it recorded twice by the M-Bus class. And that was nice. And I was in the class for the first one, so that was awesome to do that just in my class at school. That's awesome. Shout out M-Bus. And for Live in the Lobby, the WUOG friends were nice enough to record it for me because they put it out on the airwaves and all that good stuff. And that was a fun one. And for Furnace 41, I had Michael Norton there, the sound guy, record it for me. And that was awesome as well. I think that was the best sound quality out of the three, which is pretty cool. And yeah, I did two songs from each because I don't think we really had like a full show that was like amazing. You know what I mean? So like, I just like picked and choose from each show, and that gives a little like recap of the year. And picked two from 40 Watt, which would be Overflows, which is the intro, and Heavy Dependence, which is the last song. And then two from Furnace, Ain't Talking About Love, Van Halen cover. And let's see, what was it? Too Odd to Hold, which would be our last single. And two from Live in the Lobby would be Mr. Lift Driver, which is a song I was playing live for the first couple shows. And then it kind of panned away, but I'm going to release a studio version eventually. And Stay Awake, which is one of my favorite songs I released, probably the third or fourth single. Yeah. So it really, what I really like about the whole idea of the Live in 2020 record is that it's exactly how we were right then in that moment. Like, literally, the 40 Watt show that you hear on the record is the second show I ever played, second show with a full band, second time playing in front of an audience, and it was at fucking 40 Watt Club, you know what I'm saying? So that was awesome. That was just a great moment for me. I just look forward to listening back to that in like 5 or 10 years and being like, holy shit, we weren't that bad for the second show, you know what I'm saying? So yeah, that for that one, let's talk about that one for a little while. That one was on January 10th. Somehow we lucked into that show. Shout out Bradley Reeves, hooked us up with that one. And we were opening for Shameless James and Al Dente. And it was literally like, just like I dreamed of playing the 40 Watt Club when I was a kid and shit. And you read about REM and Red Hot Chili Peppers and Nirvana, of course, all playing there. And you just want to fucking play there, you know what I'm saying? So yeah, I wanted to play there forever. And then we played one show at Flickr and lucked up. And somehow our next show 2 weeks later was at fucking 40 Watt Club. Which is awesome. I mean, that's just like dream come true right there. I was like, let's go. And we opened, which is a nice spot to be in, I think. Or back then I did. I really liked to have the opening slot. It was fun. And we only played like 30 minutes. Like maybe 30 minutes. I want to feel like we didn't even touch 30 minutes. But it was a good time. And I pulled my two favorites from those, which I've just been listening to on SoundCloud for like since it happened, which was over a year ago. So I've just been listening to it on SoundCloud whenever I wanted to hear it. I was like, fuck this, man. Why is this shit on Spotify? Like, let's get it mixed. Let's see if somebody can make it sound good and put it out there. And like, the energy's there. Like, one of my favorite parts of it is you can hear at the start, Miles starts yelling in the intro. And at the end, when I'm thanking Athens, thanking everybody from Athens for coming out, I think that's really cool. And yeah, I was like, the energy feels good. We're hitting on all cylinders, kind of. It's just a fun one. And yeah, so another spot, I wrote spots to note about this. My guitar becomes, I had my pedal board set up right in front of me, and I stepped on the output on the right side. So I unplugged my guitar, not once, but twice. I only did it once and overflows, but if you hear me in the first chorus say I'm back, it's around like the 1 minute mark. You hear me yell, I'm back, and it doesn't really make sense because you can't see a video. I am simply talking about I fucking plugged my guitar back in and I'm back. So yeah, I think that's a funny stuff like that. I mean, that's stuff you don't hear on the studio recording, which is great. You know what I'm saying? That's fun. And I really love that drum intro. It was cool. I feel like the energy on Heavy Dependence is good. I like the guitar. I think it's really funny to hear myself as a one guitar band now, because now obviously we have Bryce, which is amazing. And it's honestly unreal that I even used to have to hold it down with one guitar, that I was even able to do it. Did it okay at best. I definitely love the two guitar so much more. And it's just funny because like when I stopped playing guitar in the three piece, like it was like really quiet, you know what I'm saying? Like all the melody, or not all the melody, but you know what I'm saying? Like you know how a three piece is. When the guitar stops, your high end's gone. But yeah, it's cool to listen back to. I think that's really fun. And next up would have been in order would be Live in the Lobby, which is actually like surprisingly such a great time. I think of Samantha, who booked us there, which she is the director of Live in the Lobby. Shout out Samantha. She booked us, and I can't remember the kid's name who recorded us, but he was such a nice guy. If he's watching this, shoot me a DM. And yeah, we were on the waves, on the airwaves. We played on the radio for like 45 minutes. And it's funny because in the lobby, they can't hear you sing because there's no monitors on them. There's just monitors on us. And they can't hear what you're singing, really. And you're just imagine just being in that little bitty WUOG lobby on UGA's campus. And just like seeing a band of three guys just going fucking ballistic in there, playing ridiculously loud, like blindingly loud, and just mouthing. You can't hear anything. You can't hear any words. It's just like what the fuck could they be saying? You know what I'm saying? And people sat in there and watched and filmed that bitch for like 45 minutes or however long it took. But yeah, they were all super nice. It was great. And I remember that being like the point last year. I was like, man, we're really hitting a stride, like on the set list and everything. It felt really good. We were having a fun time. We were starting to get really goofy with it. And yeah, for that one, I did Mr. Lift Driver because I feel like that was an important one to the early segment of the Jameson Tank, which I call it 1.0. And it was an important song that like we played, and it was kind of hype and it was fun. And it kind of fell out. I don't really want to play it anymore, you know what I'm saying? So I felt like that was important to include. And also Stay Awake, that's another one that I really loved playing, but like I think I'm past playing it right now. Like I just don't need it. Like I'm just moving along, you know. You don't want to keep looking back or whatever. But yeah, that's why I included those. So I'm excited about those. And that the only thing I wish about that one is that there was a crowd, so they all had a crowd in them. But you take what you can get, you know what I mean? I only played 10 or so shows last year, so you take what you can get on the their show recordings, because it's not easy to get them recorded sometimes. So yeah, that's the WUOG in the Lobby one. And then the next one, probably my favorite one, would be Ain't Talking About Love and Too Hot to Hold from Furnace. This is our first show back post-COVID, December 12, 2020. First show with a new lineup, Connor, Bryce, Javier, and we call this 2.0, or I do. And it was just awesome, just a great night. We went up there to Atlanta. We never played in Atlanta. We don't know a fucking soul up there. And a lot of my great friends showed out, like they do all the shows, which is just fantastic. You just can't beat that. Friends traveling over an hour and a half to come see you. And it's just a cool venue. I don't know if you guys ever been to Furnace 41, but we were really pleased with the turnout, and the just the venue's cool. They sell food. They got like two stages. We played the small stage. The sound is fantastic. The sound guy, Michael, really knows what he's doing. He recorded the stems for this. Shout out, Michael. Thank you for that. And yeah, it was just a great night. It was like, yeah, we can do this again. And it was just post-COVID, or right at the end of when concerts kind of starting back. And it was nice to just be like, man, we're back and we still got it. You know what I mean? For me, it's me personally, it was like, yeah, that was a good little 6 months to hone your craft. Got the new group and we're back. And I always like telling this story, but Javier, we'd only known Javier for like 2 weeks at this point. And he learns the set list in like maybe a week. Like he agreed like the week of. I was like, yeah, I can learn it for Saturday. And dude just knocked it out and just plays an amazing set. And I really love his bass sound on Ain't Talking About Love, which is great. I mean, I ain't talking about love. Well, yeah, I ain't talking about love, but also even more, I like it on Too Hot to Hold. because it just sounds fucking huge. And yeah, he's got a 5-string bass. 4 wasn't enough for him. So yeah, shout out Javier, shout out Connor, shout out Bryce. They are on Ain't Talking About Love and Too Hot to Hold. And they were a big part of making this one happen. They helped me get it mixed and everything. And they were just like, it feels like our kind of project, even though they didn't play on everything. But yeah, I'm looking forward to everybody getting a chance to hear it and all that stuff. I got some videos coming out from these shows, hopefully soon, probably this week. And yeah, I think that was all I wanted to note. Oh, I did want to note on Ain't Talking About Love, in the bridge, when it breaks down and it does this little harmonics thing that Eddie Van Halen does that we really liked. And sometimes I play it, sometimes Bryce plays it, and we get to it, and you hear it's just like it stops, and then neither of us play it, and you can hear me go like ah, because I'm kind of laughing, and then we just hit a little like chunking on it, which is just, it's just funny if you were there, I guess. The band knows what I mean, like it's just funny, like little mistakes like that, and stuff in like Too Hot to Hold, like I'm talking to somebody verse 2. I wish I wasn't, but I'm just talking to, I think it's Crunk, maybe, shout out Matthew Crunkleton. I think I was trying to get Crunk hyped. And I'm joking with Tyler in verse 1 of Ain't Talking About Love. Just good stuff like that. Stuff that's notable for me. And I really hope you guys enjoy it. Yeah, it was nice to hear the progressions of the band too. Like you can listen to the first or the Live in the Lobby and the Woo Wog shows. One guitar, 3-piece, Miles and Vic. And then you listen to the current lineup, which should be Bryce, Connor, Javier, me. 2 guitars, 3 singers, great drums, bass, extra guitar. Did I say that already? It's just fucking fantastic. It sounds massive. We sat in here and listened in this room. Javier was in California, but we listened to it. And we were just getting hype in here, man. It just felt good. It feels like a good, like my head just gets to bobbing when I listen to it, and I just really enjoy it. I think the mixes came out great. This is another thing I have to talk about. It was mixed by Jeffrey Vernon, good friend of mine. Shout out Jeff. He is a fantastic mixer, dude. He's just an absolute wizard. He's got his whole little studio going in Madison, Georgia, not too far from Athens. He's got a tape recorder. He's got just mixing console. He's got these huge speakers. Dude has just got it going on. And he just made that shit sound massive. So shout out Jeff. No doubt I probably wouldn't have got it done if Jeff wasn't on the mixing for this one. Really just let him do it. I had very few revisions too. And I'm pretty picky on the mix. And that man just had it going. Shout out Jeff. So I hope we can shout it again. I was hoping we'd work on some more stuff. I was talking to him about it, and I was talking to the band. I was like, hey, we keep recording shows and playing shows. Maybe we'll do a live record every year. You know what I'm saying? Like, there's no point in just leaving it on the shelves. You know what I'm saying? And not many people are dropping live records these days. So I like that. And I took some notes from the jam bands around town and stuff. They will straight up just like play a show and then post the stems on Friday from the show, the whole show. I love that. I mean, that's content. You know what I'm saying? And what else are you going to do with it? You know what I mean? It's just going to be so fun to look back at it in like 15 years, be like, man, that's crazy. I remember everything about that show now that I listen back. And people that were there, hopefully they can get some entertainment out of it. And people who weren't there, I hope you guys all can enjoy it. So yeah, I just wanted to get on and do a little podcast tonight with myself. That's fun. Always nice talking to myself. And thanks everybody for giving me a little holiday. I wrote that down. Thank you all for sticking with me while I'm taking some time off from the podcast. We have 2 run of shows coming up. Maddie's Pub on March 13th and Sunset Auction House on March 19th. Very excited about those shows. We're getting ready. We're playing every night. And this Wednesday should have a podcast coming out with Connor Akeridge. We're going to talk about NFTs and cryptocurrency and the music industry. So I'm very excited about that. Yeah, I think that's it. My favorite track from it would be either Ain't Talking About Love. It's kind of fun, man. It's a cover, I know, but I love that one. And either that, Heavy D, or Too Hot to Hold. I know that's 3, but one of those 3. Definitely my favorite. So yeah, that was really it. I mean, thanks to everybody who recorded it. Thanks to everybody who took part. Give yourself a little round of applause. Thanks to everybody who listened. Thanks to everybody who shared. I mean, I just appreciate it. Appreciate you guys supporting the podcast. Everything. Thank you for listening in. If you listen to all 14 minutes of this, I really appreciate it. If you would like to subscribe on YouTube, that would be fucking fantastic. Trying to get my subscribers up, trying to monetize and all that good stuff. If you want to subscribe on Instagram, it's Jameson_on_the_rocks. Subscribe on Apple Podcasts if you listen on there. Subscribe on Spotify Podcasts if you listen there. Yeah, just help me out, and I'm going to try to keep the content coming at you. If you guys have any suggestions on bands that could come on, hit me up. I would love to hear them. I would love to take part. So, yeah, thank you guys all for tuning in. It's always a pleasure. Jameson out. See ya.
We got one more for you. It's called Heavy Dependence. Thank you guys so much for coming out. We love you all. Georgia. We love you. Let me hear you. Come on.